of course, we got very little time with him. Live right now, of course. Guest of the afternoon, of course, owner of Global Force Wrestling, former WWE, WCW, and TNA star, the man himself, Jeff Jarrett. Welcome, brother.
Thank you, man. I appreciate Evan having me on, and looking forward to chatting all things Global Force Wrestling today.
Yes, how you feeling?
Oh, cool. Thank you, bro.
Hello?
Yes, can you hear us fine?
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Yep. Okay, yes. good.
Good. Well, thank you for coming on to the show, of course. I know you're a very busy man. I want to start things off right now. Of course, Global Force Wrestling, you know, we were at one of the Global Force events doing media work for you guys in Pennsylvania. We really enjoyed it. Had a chance to talk to you and Kevin Nash and Gene Snitsky and Chris Masters was all there. I just want to say, tell us, what is upcoming? What can we look for at Global Force in 2016?
Well, we've got, ironically enough, that's right, I met you guys at Harrisburg, and I'm actually at the Opryland Hotel in Nashville for the baseball winter meetings 2015, and we're talking the Grand Slam Tour for next year and talking to a bunch of the teams, talking to the teams that we went to this year and then talking to a bunch of new teams for next year. So that's in the early planning stages. But just today we announced our first two live events of 2016. We're going to Poughkeepsie, New York, and Rahway, New Jersey, in January 22nd, 23rd. Very, very excited about that. And then we talk about this as well, is that, you know, at Global Force, we try to be, you know, do things a little bit differently and reach the fans in different ways. And probably about 3 or 4 months ago, there's a company called Ridge Rock Entertainment, who is a Hollywood film company, and they produced a movie called The Masked Saint, and it was one of Roddy Piper's last movies that he did, and they approached us about basically being a marketing arm or a marketing consultancy type deal for the movie to the wrestling fan. And quite frankly, over the last 3 or 4 months, it's turned into not just a consultancy deal, but almost a passion of mine, because the movie is so good. Roddy's so good in it. It tells a great story. It's a faith-based movie, but when you watch it, the wrestling is done so well and treated with so much respect. The story is so well done that it will appeal to all audiences, secular, faith-based, and it's just a really good movie, and we're excited about that. It launches nationwide Friday, January 8th. We've got the premiere here in Nashville on January 7th, and a lot of big names coming in for that. Diane Carroll's in that movie. So it's exciting times in Global Force Wrestling. Got lots to talk about.
All right. Definitely can't wait to see it. NFC Game Boy?
Well, my question for you is kind of universal. It has to do with Global Force, and it also has to do with your past history in the business. Do you mind if I tap into that real quick?
Sure.
Okay. You are considered an architect. If you think of Vince McMahon, you know, the WWE, you think of Paul Heyman, you think of ECW, you think of Ted Turner and Eric Bischoff, the WCW days, and then you see yourself from back in the TNA days. You are the only person that I've seen as a wrestler who's been in the back room, in the boardroom, and was running a company. And now that you're running Global Force, what lessons do you think you have learned from being a worker, a wrestler, a world champion, a multiple champion, and now being a boss, a CEO, and someone who's, you know, I guess wearing a title more suits than straps?
Wow. What have I learned? It's, you know, I've been in the business. My family's been in the business over 70 years. I'm fastly approaching my 30th year in this business being an active wrestler. So that takes in a lot of ground and a lot of experience of learning things, what to do, what not to do, the ebb and flow of different things. Obviously, the business has grown so much, but so has technology and society and all forms of sport or entertainment. We consume our content on our phones, and you couldn't do that, when I broke in. You had to watch the 1 hour on a Saturday morning or a Saturday night, and then, you know, obviously we went through the Monday Night Raw launching and then Nitro, and then it became a Monday staple, and then they added the network shows, and then you went from, you know, Nitro and Thunder, Raw and SmackDown, and the monthly pay-per-views, and just the content has grown. And now, you know, the WWE has done a masterful job with their network, $9.99 a month, and thousands and thousands and thousands of old content, but then they're producing all their, you know, the pay-per-views are on there and new shows. So the business has grown, but I always, and this is a lesson that my grandmother taught me, and you know, if she were alive today, she would probably be amazed at just how much the business has grown. But
right.
At the end of the day, when you look back on every, in my opinion, when you look back on every time in this business when it's been really successful, the territory days, in, you know, 80 from 85, the business was red hot all over the country, essentially. Then you go into your attitude era, and then you have certain things that you just look at, different promotions around the world. New Japan is red hot. AAA is on a run, and they have been for multiple years. When you drill it all away and sort of take away technology and take away politics and take away everything you want to take away, at the end of the day, what happens bell to bell is just vital. It is the foundation that, and yes, you can have cool entrances and slang, you know, hip catchphrases and,
right.
and cool production elements and pyro and just all of that that goes to. But if you look at one thing that sort of stood the test of time, dating back to the 40s or 50s, is that you have to have great bell-to-bell action. There is no replacement for that. And because, you know, you can have great talkers and great promos and great promotions and get an audience there one time, I mean, maybe two times. But if you don't deliver and make it a very, very entertaining a contest, you don't get them back. So I believe above anything, that is the vital key. That is the common denominator in all periods of the business when you had a lot of success.
Yes,
thank you for that.
Yeah, we do agree with that too. And like I said, you've been everywhere. You work just about everywhere. And we definitely want to give a shout out to you, Jeff, to your dad, Jerry Jarrett. Hopefully, you know, all is well with him as well. Want to ask you too. The TV taping is coming up. I know you do AMP TV for Global Force. A lot of fans has been hitting us up ever since we brought the news about you coming on, asking people want to know, when can we see Global Force on TV? A lot of people just anticipating and waiting to see it. Can you shed any light on that?
Sure. The great thing is we went to Las Vegas July, August, and October. Those were our first three television tapings. We're in the process of scheduling the next round of tapings for first quarter of 2016, and we put out an announcement, I guess a couple of weeks ago, that we have an international agency, Boulder Creek International. There's television conferences all around the globe, Sportel, MIPCOM, and then there was just a conference last week in Singapore. This week, Boulder Creek spent 2 days in Vietnam is where the conference was held. So that covers our international front, that we're out. We have 16 one-hour episodes, and it's no secret that on those episodes, it's four tournaments to build the champions. And we couldn't be happier because it is a different show. It is going to be something that you, quite frankly, haven't really seen before, a lot of docu-style. So there's a lot of lots and lots of manpower, of editing, and the guys, and showing them at home, and different styles. It's a different type, unique field show. And then here domestically in the U.S., we'll be making an announcement. We're probably going to push it out to the first year about a company based out of L.A. that we're working with. And we got some exciting things on the horizon. And when we make the announcement, and I've said this going back over a year, we're going to give everyone the opportunity that wants to see AMP that opportunity. And, you know, that's multiple forms of distribution. It's no secret that we consume our content more than on the big screen these days. There's multiple ways, and that's what we're strategizing and quite frankly, formulating and putting it together, that it will be a global launch of AMP programming.
No, thank you.
Smart.
We'll ask you a question. I'm going to turn it over to my correspondent real quick. Is where can you assure Jeff? It's okay to call you Jeff or Mr. Jarrett. What can you assure us, assure the fans? A lot of people want to say, well, Jeff, he got Global Force, and we don't want to be another TNA. And, you know, TNA is in the mix right now, what they're going through, and WWE ratings are in decline, and, you know, Ring of Honor trying to do TV. What, Jeff, can you tell the fans that are listening live and that are listening archive? What can you assure them that will be different with Global Force that you won't get from TNA, that you won't get from Ring of Honor and WWE?
Well, from the very first event that we came out with that we brought to the North America, obviously it was New Japan event, and they covered all the wrestling aspects. We brought Jim Ross on board. We like to do things just a little different, and you can go to our YouTube page at GFW Wrestling, and you can sort of get sneak peeks dating all the way back to how we promoted and produced the stories and the matches and the matchups for New Japan, and then as we rolled through Grand Slam this past year, and then the tidbits that we've released through our YouTube page, that gives you a taste of it. But once amped, you'll see it takes it to another level. And it, to me, it's got a real authenticity feel to it.
Yes, and next, you know, with us, with my staff and all of us being at Global Force events, we definitely love it. And it does have a different feel too. It does. Go ahead, Toph. Go ahead, our correspondent.
Hey, Mr. Jarrett, we got a question. Can you explain why are the Global Force colors green? I know a lot of wrestling fans like to pay attention. You guys chose green for your color. And can you explain exactly, like, what is the next-gen title? Like, what is that supposed to represent for the company?
Well, green, it's got a global feel. And if you look at our logo, you know, any logos it's made, it's got, you know, a blue and green tinge to it. And we just... believe it or not, there was actually two different, you can call them marketing/graphic companies that we consulted with, and that green, in my opinion, pops. And, you know, I think when you see the ring and see the green rope, it just has a different feel to it. That's something that you just referenced. There, you know, there's TNA out there, and they're going to have their look. Ring of Honor has their look and their colors. WWE and Raw has their look and color. So, you know, you, there's only so many colors in the spectrum, the color spectrum. So we liked it. It popped, and it had a real good feel, and it matched up well with the global aspect of our branding. Your second question was the next-gen title. And that's something that... As I left TNA Wrestling and took a couple of months on and started to formulate plans and then literally traveled the globe and compiled the database, that at times people were like, come on, you know, but the database truly exists. And because I wanted to get every wrestler that has ability that is not contracted to the other companies, I wanted to get them all in some type of place. And when you look at different styles and then – thank goodness there's YouTube now, but you don't have to travel all the time to see everybody, and guys can post matches and do that, and I've spent hours and hours, and several of us at Global Force have. You look at some of the styles that guys have now, it's the next generation of wrestling. It isn't done the way it was been done over the last 10 years. So there's a next generation feel to it. And then there's guys that we all seen that come in and they're, you know, not really playing themselves. They're trying to be somebody they're not, and just finding their way. But all it takes is them to sort of reinvent themselves, re-energize themselves. And so it's the next generation of who they are. And so it's a little double meaning there, but it's something that we wanted guys that had that style that I'll say is not a traditional. I don't even want to call it heavyweight, but a traditional style. Next gen has a little different flavor to it.
All right. Thank you for that. Now, how much time we got with you, Jeff? We got a few more minutes with you?
Just very few. Yeah, I want to. Great, and I apologize. I want to keep on the schedule, but got a couple of more minutes here.
It's fine. Okay. You're a busy man. We're happy with that. I want to ask you, of course, fan questions. All the people, Mr. Jarrett, that you have hit in the head with a guitar, who was the most memorable?
Now, I always let fans answer that. I'll let the your host and your co-host. I'd rather hear you because there's so many different ones, wrestlers, non-wrestlers. They're still to this day. The two that probably get the most talked about are Beetlejuice and Moolah, and it's You know, it was Moolah was certainly shocking in its day, and no one expected me to hit Beetlejuice. So the shock, like he really just smashed a head guitar over a 72-year-old woman. That was unique for us. So I'll let you guys answer.
Okay. Well, you said, you know, we had to ask for the fans asked it, so we asked. Go ahead, NSC.
Well, I definitely wanted to know about the Beetlejuice thing. I know Toph wanted to ask the question of why, and I guess you're giving the answer to the surprise. My last question to you is that, you know, by you having worked with TNA and everything that's gone on, and now with Global Force, and Global Force has gotten so much momentum, so much praise, and so much light, are you afraid that you might make the same mistakes as before? You know, this is the first time that I can really say a wrestler, a performer, an athlete is really running a company of this stature. And, you know, everyone else is considered, quote-unquote, businessmen. And, you know, for you to be in the limelight that you are and holding the title and the mantle that you are you any way, any shape or form, afraid that you might make the same mistakes?
Look, I have always had a real good mentality that you swing for the fences and you're not always going to hit home runs, but you got to take calculated risks. We're certainly going to make mistakes. That's life, not just in business, but in life. We all make mistakes, and the only thing we can do is when we make mistakes is pull ourselves up by our bootstraps and keep on keeping on. But one thing that we're well aware of is that we collectively get in a room and discuss things. And that's why, from a real step-by-step basis, we've taken our time on things. And at times, I know in my career, and look, my family, we come from, yes, I've wrestled actually 30 years, but my family has been a part of the promotion side of this business, like I said, for 70 years. So lots of ebbs and flows and ups and downs. And so I've always looked at it more from just, you know, obviously I had to look at it from a wrestler's perspective for many years, but at the same time, I always looked at it from a business perspective and how to grow things. And I can remember very fondly when I first went to the WWF, just the enormous production capabilities. And as in 93, and even back then, they were huge. And that's something that I was always fascinated by. You know, as a young kid, I was fascinated by concessions and making money off concessions, and then, you know, we'll call it the merchandise business, but now it's much more than merchandise, it's licensing. So are we going to make mistakes? Absolutely. Are we going to learn from our mistakes? Absolutely. I just hope we don't make the same mistakes, because that would be shame on me.
Right.
No
Thank
problem,
you for that.
No,
just want to say real quick, Jeff, shout out to our friend Evan Ginsberg, associate producer of the movie The Wrestle with Mickey Rourke. Said a big fan of yours, and he was there when you wrestled the Moondogs in Mid-South with Mid-South Coliseum with Jerry Lawler. So he just wanted to put that out there.
Tell Evan hello, and that was hardcore before it was called hardcore. Those matches were brutal.
So, but I said, Jeff, it's been an honor. Thank you much for coming on to your show. We'll be talking to your people. Hopefully we can have you back on a little longer and talk more about your career.
Sure, I appreciate it. And as usual, as always, you guys do, love the social media, love you guys, and we'll return it. And you can follow all of us, for anybody listening to this that isn't aware of our social media handles, all of them, YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and all of them are at GFW Wrestling. It's at GFW Wrestling. So I appreciate it, guys. And we'll talk soon.
Thank you, Jeff.
Thank
Take
you,
care,
Jeff.
Man.
Thank you.
Everybody, that was good. J-E-F-F, J-E-R-E-T, Jeff Jarrett, Mr. Slapness himself, owner of Global Force Wrestling. Of course, check them out all over YouTube and Twitter. Do apologize. I know we've been getting tons of inboxes and people tweeting us and people hitting us up, do an email about Jeff. Jeff was, of course, live radio was scheduled to be a lot longer, but he has a lot of business, a lot of things to take care of. But we thank you, Global Force. Thank you, Jeff, for taking the time out of your busy schedule to come on our show. We will have Jeff back on very soon. We spoke off air, so we can talk more about his career, about TNA, WWE, WCW, and everything else. While we can right now, while we got time, I'm going to bring it right now, good old buddy Angry Mark. Welcome, man.